Hey folks, this is Abel James, and thanks so much for joining us on the Fat Burning Man Show, where we talk about real food and real results. How are your food prep and cooking skills looking these days? When it comes to growing, preparing, and storing our own food, life skills that our ancestors considered critical to survival are being lost to time. These survival skills are too important to lose. So if you're looking to save time and money in the kitchen by getting back to your roots, we have the show for you. Today, we're here with the wonderful Hilary Boynton, an author, certified holistic health counselor, and multi-talented mother of five. Hilary is also a Weston A. Price chapter leader, runs several local food co-ops, helped to open a farm-to-table restaurant in Massachusetts, and teaches cooking classes out of her home in California. But before we get to the interview, here's a review of Fat Burning Man that came in from Samboni on iTunes. He says, I'm so thankful to have found this show. It led me to the book I rave about to all my family and friends, The Wild Diet. The mindset, principles, and tips in this book helped me to lose that stubborn 20 pounds and keep it off. I couldn't believe how simple and easy it was. I'm not only impressed with the physical results, but the mental results from the tips in this podcast. At a time when my job had been very stressful, I realized how important my diet and exercise is when it comes to focus. I can't even begin to explain the mental clarity I feel day to day. I feel like I have an upper hand or unfair advantage to everyone else by being in the know from all the underground leaders in health who come on this show and blow my mind. Lastly, my favorite part is that the cravings are gone. I look forward to eating veggies and real food, and I'm inspired to cook more, know that I can eat really, really delicious things and not feel guilty. I highly recommend you tune in and get on this bacon train with me. Samboni, that's an amazing, amazing note. This totally made my day. Thank you for riding the bacon train with us and for your words about the wild diet, as well as your sincere review here. It really makes a big difference, and this show spreads because of word of mouth from people like you, so we really appreciate it. And when it comes to the underground leaders in health, it does certainly feel like that, doesn't it, these days? But we all need to help get each other's back, support each other. So if there are other people you'd like to see on this show, or if you'd just like to get in touch, drop me a line at abel@fatburningman.com. That's abel@fatburningman.com. You can also leave a review wherever you're watching this show or listening to it. And if you'd like to help support us, go to fatburningman.com. You can check out our store. We've got a tip jar. I give away my best-selling book of humor and satire, Designer Babies Still Get Scabies, as an ebook and an audiobook when you sign up for our Patreon and our tip jar. We also have the Fat Burning Tribe at fatburningtribe.com. That's our coaching community. We're coming out with a new app soon. And finally, if you're in the U.S., and you'd like to help support us while getting the highest quality nutrients you possibly can, head on over to wildsuperfoods.com. We recently launched a couple of brand new products, which I really think you're going to dig. The first is one of my personal favorites. It's an adaptogenic herb and nutrient cocktail called Adrenal Stack. Sometimes, you know, I just finished a really rough week. Our truck got eaten up by a bunch of rodents. It's going to cost thousands of dollars. I recorded, you know, 6+ interviews in one day. We've got a bunch of intros to record, new shows, and trips to plan. So when life stacks up and it feels like everything's stacked against you, Adrenal Stack is your best friend. You'll be getting 111% of your daily recommended dose of vitamin C, along with a synergistic blend of adaptogenic herbs and nutrients, including American ginseng, rhodiola, ashwagandha, B vitamins, Siberian ginseng, licorice, and more. So to try this powerful combo of nutrients and botanicals, a stack of my personal favorites, head on over to wildsuperfoods.com. And the other product we're extremely proud of that just launched, getting great feedback already, is called Collagen Cocoa. It's a bone broth protein sourced from cows raised on pasture, just the way that nature intended, mixed with high quality cocoa powder, medium chain triglycerides, and just a little bit of stevia for sweetness. You get a giant container of it. It weighs 1.8 pounds and lasts, for us, usually more than a month. It depends on how quickly you're going through through it, but it's a great source of protein, shelf-stable, and also works really well in puddings, brownies, gummies, and other desserts that we're coming up with. Collagen cocoa from Wild Superfoods is dairy-free, non-GMO, gluten-free, soy-free, and guaranteed GMP compliant. It's delicious mixed right in water. I actually like drinking it hot a lot of the time with a splash of heavy cream in there to make a little hot cocoa, especially after my runs and my workouts. It's great to have that easy and convenient source of protein, whether we're on the road or at home, just hunkering down. It's great to have around. So another thing that we're really excited about, we added the ability for Future Greens as well as collagen cocoa and our other products from Wild Superfoods. You can buy bundles and 3-packs and even 6-packs to save even more. And you can save, get a great deal. We're going to be throwing those in the next few months. So head on over to wildsuperfoods.com and we'll hook you right up. Every purchase from wildsuperfoods.com and fatburningman.com helps to support this show and keep it coming to you. So we really appreciate it now more than ever. All right, on to the show with Hilary Boynton. You're going to dig this one. We're chatting about the benefits of bone broth, fermented foods, raw foods, and using the whole animal, nose to tail. What to do if you're a kitchen newbie, the gut-brain connection, and the importance of diversity in our microbiomes. Surprising results from putting a glucose monitor on a high schooler. I'm actually wearing one right now, CGM. And tons more. Let's go hang out with Hilary. Welcome back, folks. Today we're here with the wonderful Hilary Boynton, a certified holistic health counselor, author of the Heal Your Gut cookbook, and mother of five. Hilary is also a Weston A. Price chapter leader. She runs several local food co-ops, teaches cooking classes out of her house, and even helped to open a farm-to-table restaurant in Concord, Massachusetts. Thank you so much for joining us here today, Hilary.
Thank you. It's such a pleasure to be here.
Right on. So there are a lot of people who have been thrust into a position that's uncomfortable, where they have to suddenly cook for themselves and maybe cook for their whole families, and they don't know how to get started because we've, you know, kind of been coached out of that, or we've lost a lot of the skills. And there is a skill set that you need, but once you have it, you can just kind of execute on it, and it's actually not that complicated to make it all work. So maybe you can just start a little bit with a crash course for some of the kitchen newbies.
Yeah, I mean, I couldn't agree more. I think that unfortunately we didn't, most of us did not grow up with learning that life skill of cooking, unless you'd have a grandmother or a mother that was, or dad who was really into it and that was passed down and it was a priority. But most of us kind of just, you know, unfortunately fast food or convenience came in, and it was, you know, my mom cooked every night, but it was just not, I don't know. She just wasn't, it wasn't like inherent in her to pass down these things. My grandmother, I watched at holidays and stuff, like how to make a gravy and roast turkey and stuff like that. But it certainly has been lost in the last generation or two. And it's a life skill. So I can't stress enough how important it is to get our children in the kitchen from the youngest age possible. I mean, like, sit them up on the counter and have them cracking eggs or stirring, you know, something. I mean, keep them safe, clearly, but get them engaged in whatever you can. And as a parent, yeah, it's not that it's easy when it's so uncomfortable, but you have to just step off the ledge or whatever and just make it a priority. I often say, like, with my cookbook, the hardest part of the GAPS diet is deciding to do it.
Sure. Yeah, so totally.
That commitment to say, you know what, I'm going to learn to cook and I'm going to just be gentle with myself, but I'm going to do it because I know it's the, like, probably the number one thing I can do for my children and their health and, you know, their children, my grandchildren, whatnot. And so it really is just starting the education process and, you know, seeking out your local farmers and finding the Weston Price Foundation. That's how I got started. And they have chapter leaders all around the world. So that's like a great start and say, like, hey, how do I find great pastured eggs? Or where do I find good grass-fed beef? And they'll have those answers. And so you just start scratching the surface. And I promise everybody that pretty much everywhere there are great people doing great things. You just have to find your tribe. And then you slowly start to incorporate, you know, as best you can. And just keep it real. Start to clean out the cabinets. Start to clean out the condiments. I say the condiments are like, sometimes that's just the first best step, is like the ketchups and the mayonnaise and the dressings and all those, you know, high fructose corn syrup and rancid vegetable oils. It's one of those things that I just think if you just can decide to make it a priority and start to surround yourself with great people and listening to podcasts and getting educated, it's a beautiful thing. And it's like once you go there, you can't go back really. So it just starts to unravel and people are there to help. People want to help. And so anyway, I think it's just so important.
It's true. We live in dystopia and utopia at the same time, in the sense that like we maybe didn't have the opportunity to have some of these life skills passed down to us by our family and our friends and our culture in general. But if you want to commit to it and you're curious enough, you could easily look up all the resources you need to cook almost anything, develop knife skills, juggle, you know, and everything in between. And so if you do commit to it, the resources are out there. And especially when you combine that with people in your community, real people outside of the virtual world where, yes, you can learn, but only to some extent. When you combine those things, though, then you can accomplish almost anything and build almost any skill. And cooking, people are realizing how important that is right now.
Yeah, you can share in the process of it too. You know, like mm-hmm. if you have someone making sourdough and you make ferments, or, you know, I mean, fermented foods are something that can be overwhelming for people to even try to dabble in. But there might be somebody that it's like their thing, and your thing is making bread or whatever it is. So you start to trade things or support one another, and that's a way to ease the pressure and have fun with it. But yeah, it's just so vital, and it doesn't have to be difficult. I was saying to my friend yesterday that like, God, like sometimes we eat kind of the same, you know, we have a lot of frozen ground beef and we have a lot of frozen ground pork and whole chickens and we have the organ meats and all that stuff too, but I just go for the nutrient density. I think the Food Network and all these cooking magazines and cooking shows have sort of blown it up to where there's this like expectation that you have to be making these elaborate, like photo worthy meals.
It's when a really performance, it's like, right?
Yeah, you don't have to. It can be very simple and very quick. It just, you want to get that nutrient density, right?
Yeah. I feel like a lot of people, especially recently, keto has steamrolled a lot of other concepts, and a lot of people don't realize that some of the foundation and real principles go back a long time. And Weston A. Price, I think it doesn't get enough credit in general or attention. So maybe you can, for some of the people who aren't familiar, what's the deal with that? And maybe a little bit of the history too, because it's fascinating to me.
It's so fascinating, and I'm so grateful for their work. I mean, it certainly changed my life completely. And Weston Price, I mean, when I first heard of Weston Price, I was like living in Concord, Massachusetts, and I'm like, what is Weston Price? Like the next town over was Weston. So I was like, is it a town? Like, what are we talking about here? And my friend happened to be a chapter leader. And she kept showing me these magazines and stuff. I'm like, what is going on? And,
right. Is this a cult?
She sat me down and explained it. I'm like, oh. And so Weston A. Price is the name of a dentist who lived in the 20s and 30s in Ohio. And he noticed all sorts of changes happening in his patients, from narrowing of the jaw and crooked teeth and more cavities and more disease that didn't used to be there. And he and his wife set out on a journey around the world to all these non-industrialized little pockets, these little villages and tribes that were living off the land pretty much, and they were thriving free of disease. And so he looked in every single person's mouth. He calculated how many, you know, if they had any cavities. They're all like, you know, beautiful broad bone structure. No cavities, no heart disease, no cancer. They would have like green slime on their teeth sometimes, but no cavities.
Yeah.
And so they just, like, vibrant health from the Swiss Alps to the Aborigines, the Maasai. And they had these commonalities across the board. I mean, they had these nutrient dense foods from bone broths and fermented foods and raw foods and using the whole animal. And I mean, even he thought that he was going to find the vegetarian diet to be the most prevalent, but it was not the case. So even those who were eating a lot of plants had insects and things that were giving him those fat soluble vitamins, the A and the D and all of that. So, and he studied. He photographed them all, and he wrote a book called Nutrition and Physical Degeneration. And then he looked at one generation removed, when in came the white flour and the white sugar, in came the narrowing of the jaw and the crooked teeth and the cavities and disease and so on and so forth. So it's just this, it's like a big aha of like, oh my gosh, like the denatured foods and all the processing just really kind of sucks the life out of us. And your teeth or your mouth is just like an indication of the health of the rest of your body. And so we're so lucky that he did his work, because I don't know that we could find that, you know, now. So much has changed. And so, you know, I was saying to somebody today that we were talking about organ meats, and it's so squeamish for so many of us, but it was so valuable back in the day. I mean, they had like fertility diets and preconception diets, and their, you know, their whole job was to make sure that their people moved forward and had healthy babies. And so we just don't think like that anymore. And so we don't value food the same way. So now the foundation, Sally Fallon started this foundation, I think almost 20 years ago now, because I've been involved for 15, maybe 13. And again, like I said, there's chapter leaders all around the world, and they just are all about healthy babies and empowering people and giving these, you know, very, very important messages that not a lot of people are doing right now. I think it's, you know, I'm like, why isn't everybody shouting from the rooftops, like, let's get healthy, America? Like, the number one way to fight off infection or viruses or whatever is to have a healthy immune system. And that starts with diet and lifestyle. So, you know, I could go on and on. I'm very grateful for their work.
And when you look at the diets that he recommends and that, you know, the whole body of work around that work and the other generations of that work, whatever, it just shows you how divorced our reality is from that. You look around at the people, you look around at what everyone's eating and what has been normalized, whether you're in a restaurant, a school, or just at home. It's really quite abysmal. It's certainly not progress.
No, it's so sad to me. I mean, I think, like I was saying with the condiments, just the rancid vegetable oils and the amount of sugar and everything is just so, it's become normal.
Yeah.
And nobody questions it, and nobody is really aware. Like, that every time you go out to eat, even if it's a really nice restaurant, you're probably going to be consuming soybean oil or canola oil or some sort of processed rancid vegetable oil that is really taking its toll. Was it you that did the podcast with Kate Shanahan? Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, it's unbelievable what these oils are doing to us physically, and nobody has any idea.
Yeah.
Any idea. And because it's a silent, it's like, it'd be better if you would just like eat it and drop dead.
Mm-hmm.
But we don't. It's just like this long, slow process of getting, you know, deterioration. And so, you know, with the sugar, it's unbelievable too. We've done a study at the school, a citizen science study with blood glucose monitors, continuous blood glucose monitors, and have students and parents and teachers and chefs all wearing these monitors to show directly how food affects your blood glucose levels. And so it was like really an empowerment tool just to say, like, if you're a chef or a parent or a teacher, whatever, feeding children and yourself, mm-hmm. but if you see that, oh wow, that plate of food that I was gonna give the kids just shot my blood glucose level, skyrocketed, like, why would I have to have a certain accountability in how I'm feeding people? And I don't know, my conscience couldn't handle that if I knew that I was pushing kids kind of directly into the medical system. And that's what's happening.
And the immediate threat of them spinning out of control and just getting hysterical, right? Because they're so high on sugar. You don't want to deal with that.
We want them to sit still and to learn. And you know, there's just so many behavioral problems in kids. And the kids don't really understand. I mean, there's a little video that we did that's in my link in my bio, and it was probably 3 years ago. And we interviewed these two little sixth grade boys, and one of them, just unprompted, was like, I used to feel like this all day long, and now I just feel like this.
Wow.
I was like, there's my 30-second ad right there. I was just like, that is exactly what we're talking about. They don't know. They're too young to kind of know why they're feeling off the wall, and then they're crashing, and, you know, they don't know, but they know when they feel good. And I think most people don't know what it feels like to feel good, adults included.
Yeah, I would agree with that. And it takes some, well, when you look at even just, I remember back to when I was in elementary school, some of the, you know, government free lunches are just like these deep fried, what are those things? French toast sticks, right? With these fake Eggos and these fake pizzas, and just so grim. But that was par for the course. And then, you know, there's like the coveted junk food that the other kids have. And so if you come in, even with anything homemade, that was highly irregular when I was growing up.
Yeah. I remember in fourth grade going to like throw my homemade lunch away. And the principal was like, wait a minute. And he like made me sit back down and eat it. And I was like mortified.
Wow.
Mortified that I had like all the homemade lunch, you know. But now I appreciate it so much. And, you know, I think I was listening to a podcast the other day. The school lunch program, the free and reduced, all that started to really boost up our military, make sure that we had everybody's fed well. And now it's like we, you know, our military is just like people are failing. They can't get into the military because they're overweight and have all these, you know, underlying conditions that are not going to, you know, we don't want them defending our nation or they won't survive. So it's really, sometimes it's just really hard for me to wrap my brain around how we've gone so far in the wrong direction. I mean, money clearly plays a huge role, but the consciousness and, you know, I think I said to your wife, one of the talking points is like, I'm just looking for people to put a stake in the ground for that principal to say, or that head of the hospital or that hotel to say, I'm not going to do this anymore. I don't care what it costs. I mean, cause you can figure it out. You know, it doesn't have to be like you're spending, you know, all this money. It's you have to get creative and you have to, and then you're going to sell yourself. I mean, not that, you know, a hospital wants to, you know, be like, come. But, you know, you don't want sick people, but you want to be the one that they go to if they are sick because they know that you value proper nutrition and you're not going to get like Eggos or Jell-O or juice or whatever, you know, stuff that's like feeding your cancer when you're in there for cancer treatment.
It's really, it's entering into the absurd territory.
It's absurd. It's like, but then I get back to the consciousness. Like, I think people just don't know what we think is common sense. Like, I went to look at a school for special needs kids and it was like, you know, great. Woman was super nice. The head was walking us around and I said, so what about your lunch program? And she's like, oh, the kids are having like snack right now. And the kids run the whole snack and everything. And it was all processed crap. And I was like, can't, you know, even believe this. And then she's like, well, and if we're lucky enough, when we go outside to look at their like little garden, we'll smell McDonald's French fries next door. And sometimes they just call in like Pollo Loco or I don't know, some Chick-fil-A thing. Right. And it was almost like there was a pride in it. And the kids loved the lunches. And I'm like, for special needs children, like how can you not understand the connection between diet and the, you know, the gut brain connection? And so I just think people don't know. And then when they do know, if they do know a little, it's that, it's like, you either have to block it or you have to do something about it. Cause if you know, let people, you know, let on that, you know, and you're not doing anything about it. And that can be daunting cause there's no roadmap for these schools and their hands are tied and, you know,
and marketing works. It works early too. And so for kids growing up, for us, for the generations before us, getting fast food is a status symbol. You go to, you know, third world countries, you see that. And it's like, when I saw that, you know, really exaggerated, it opened my eyes to how sinister those forces really are, how little they care about people, but how much it works.
It works. Oh, the amount of advertising to our kids and now with social media and now with virtual school, like I have 5 teenagers and it's so disheartening as a parent to see the addiction to gaming and like they think that they're going to be famous on, you know, like I have to practice more and it's like this whole thing. And then like the characters can't die or if they leave early, they get penalized. Like I'm like, dinner's ready. And it's like, well, just give me a moment. And I'm like, well, how long do you need? And it's like, well, I don't know. I'm like, well, that's not okay. And then it's just this huge battle where I'm like, is this really real right now? Like I said, dinner's ready. Like get your butt. It's so twisted but it's their world and you can't keep them completely free of it in many ways. And that's how they connect with their friends now because they have no friends, you know, they're not going to school to see their friends. So it's very tricky between, you know, food and managing phones. It's like, I don't know. I'm tempted to like go off grid some days and just.
Camping is extremely therapeutic. You go through a whole detox process. It's really.
It's rewarding. I mean, and I've tried to do that lately. I mean, I have to stay like you, like stay kind of I want to spread the message and bring, you know, hope to people, but there's also this like mama instinct of just like hunkering down and just like taking care of my unit and just being like, you know, just gotta like, I gotta make sure my own kids are not falling through the cracks. And, you know, so it's just kind of a challenging time.
Yeah, it sure is. But let's go back to the blood glucose monitoring experiments. That I'd be fascinated to hear, what were some of the surprises? What were the foods that really triggered things? What did you learn in general?
Well, I mean, one great example is one of the high school boys had like a beautiful BLT at school, bacon, lettuce, tomato on my homemade sourdough, you know, mayonnaise, the whole thing from Primal Kitchen, just like huge.
Yeah.
And he ate the whole thing. Blood glucose level was totally fine. And then he went home later that night and he had like 6 gummy worms, he said, and his blood glucose just skyrocketed and then crashed. So I was just like, you know, oh my gosh, isn't that so telling? Like, not like he's never going to eat another gummy worm again, but now he knows, huh? Like, I mean, some kids don't just eat 6 gummy worms.
Yeah, that's like, not very many for a kid. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. And so, and you think about the parents that are feeding their kids all this sugar, or the coaches that are feeding kids sugar,
juices and Gatorade. Yeah.
Mind. So it's really quick. I mean, even for me, like having an apple on an empty stomach spiked my blood glucose level. So you know, Justin, our mutual friend.
Yeah, Justin's so great.
He's big about like fruit and you know, people just think, oh, fruit's so healthy. And I'm not saying fruit is bad, but it does break down to sugar in the body. So you don't want to be, you know, thinking that that's your, you're getting all your vitamins and nutrients by just having a ton of fruit. And I have a friend actually who's just diagnosed with cancer at age 47. And she was, you know, she's like, she asked me the other day, she's like, well, so can I have some, like an apple with my neighbor's honey on top of it? I'm like, no, I'm sorry. Like, you can't. But she's like, what about a banana? I mean, it's like, it's just like it, people don't know, but fruit, the things that break down to sugar, you know, so like the processed carbohydrates and the big, you know, pastas and breads and all of that. And even with sourdough, you know, I say to people, like, you can, I believe in like a really true, long fermented whole grain sourdough that I've like freshly milled myself. I think there's but you can't eat like half a loaf and think that that's going to be healthy. So you have to have some sort of mindset around like how, you know, how you eat. And that I think too, with the Weston Price Foundation, some people, you know, are like, oh, like, oh, did they just go all in with like all these healthy foods that are healthy? But you have to understand, you have to listen to your body, you have to understand how even something that's healthy, like an apple or bread or a pasta, whatever, you want to balance things with healthy fats and proteins and whatnot. So, it's very eye-opening for a lot of people, I think, because, you know, eating late at night, drinking wine, a lot of people showed like that dysregulation all night long, you know, just by having, you can think, oh, 5 o'clock, that person's dabbling in there, you know, a couple, 2-3 glasses of wine and it's all night kind of chattery. So it's just, yeah. And stress plays a huge role. I think stress is one of the number one killers and that shows up on the blood glucose monitor. So it was really, if everybody could just wear one, it'd be awesome.
Did you find that some people or some kids could eat an orange and it was fine and others it went nuts? Did you see a lot of, you know, individuality or?
You know, we tried not to, with the kids, we tried not to make it too, they didn't like do too much recording of everything because we didn't want to create a, you know, problem around like, right, I can't eat this or I can't eat this. We're so good to kind of just watching when we serve them school lunch and stuff like that.
Sure.
So like the weekends, if it went off the rails and so, but I think certainly people do respond differently. Absolutely. Depends on your, you know, your makeup and how you metabolize foods and whatnot and what you're having it with. And again, stress and sleep and all of that is so important. And that's another huge point is that food is foundational, but all of these other, you know, like I said to my son, I'm like, you can't just be on virtual school all day and then go on with your friends for 3 hours and then come up at like 6 o'clock for dinner and think that that's okay. Like you need sunlight and exercise. And he's like, Mom, these are different times. You know, this is my generation. I'm like, you're a human. You have a heart. You have like, you know, like you bleed red. Like we're all, this is like scientifically proven. You need sunlight. You need to set your... And he's like, I'm not sleeping well. I'm like, you can't go to sleep with, like, a phone. Or, you know, so it's a lot. So there's a lot to kind of... And I'm probably the mom that's... They've heard it a million times and are so sick. It's like, wah, wah, wah.
Right.
Hopefully, they will come back. And I'm trying to pull the girlfriend card now. Like, if you're at your girlfriend's house, you know... Would you sit like this and eat, or would you, you know,
yeah,
just shove down whatever? I don't know.
It's a process.
Make sure to clear your dishes.
Yeah.
Your mouth closed. Yeah. It's a process.
Sometimes you have to learn what, you know, dabbling in the edges results in on both sides of that, right? And usually the pendulum will swing back eventually.
I mean, I went fat-free for like 10 years and got totally messed up, but I thought I knew everything. And my mom couldn't tell me anything. I was just like, whatever, you know, so.
Okay. So how about gaps? Cause I do get a lot of questions about that and very few people who can talk about it with a lot of knowledge and experience. So what's the deal with gaps?
So GAPS stands for the gut and psychology syndrome. So the gut brain connection. I guess the best way that I've heard it described, and I've probably said this on a lot of podcasts, but I think it just, I'm like a lay person's like explanation is always good for me.
Yeah.
So, I think when we understand the microbiome and the importance of the good bacteria and the bad bacteria in our guts, that we all have both and we want the good to outweigh the bad. And when and certainly sugar will feed the bad, and things like fermented foods and, you know, all the healthy real foods will feed the good bacteria in your gut. But when a baby goes through the birth canal is when they swallow a big gulp of what essentially populates is their first inoculation of their microbiome. And so if you think about me or mothers, you know, in this generation versus our great, great grandmothers and the diversity of our microbiomes and our bacteria, it doesn't compare. It's just like what Weston Price found, you know, like their health and diversity of, you know, bacteria and species living within them were so rich and amazing. And we've just lost all that through environmental toxins, through antibiotics, certainly, and processed foods. And so these babies now, I think when I wrote my book, which was in 2014, the average baby had like 247 toxins in their cord blood alone. So they're starting out with a toxic load, and then they're inheriting poor gut flora. And, you know, if you have a C-section, which all of my kids were C-section, they're not even getting that. So they're getting whatever they're picking up in the hospital and whatnot. And so they're starting out so compromised, and they might get a vaccine day one of life. Then so many kids get ear infections, get boom, put right on antibiotics. And, you know, I have a relative whose child was on like 10 rounds of antibiotics before they were two. And so then you think about that just completely wipes out the gut flora, and there's no real talk between a doctor and a patient of how you're going to rebuild that. So there's no knowledge, you know, base around that. And so, and as a new parent, you really, I know I didn't know anything. And so I just trusted. And so I can't stress enough for, you know, young moms or dads or kids who are wanting to have kids, the importance of really trying to understand. Unfortunately, it's not like your grandmother or great-grandmother are really going to start to take you under their wing and give you this information like they used to. It's like you have to do the research yourself. And so many of our children are so sick, so it's so worth doing this research. So what happens is then these babies, you know, the bad starts to outweigh the good. And now we're seeing it in a lot of like teenagers, 20-somethings, where they have like gut issues and they don't know what's going on, or they're depressed and anxious. And what happens is what you eat is supposed to go in one end and out the other, but you have these beautiful little villi on the inside of your intestinal lining that get shaved down by these bad bacteria and create cracks in the lining. And then what's supposed to stay in gets out, and your body sees them as foreign and launches an attack, which would be an autoimmune response, or they can cross the blood-brain barrier and cause, you know, neurological issues. So we're kind of in this like pandemic of bad bacteria outweighing the good. And unfortunately it's like, you know, there's so many variables down going on in there that what is happening with you isn't going to be happening with me, isn't going to be happening with the next person. Everyone's so different. So it's very hard to peel back the layers and find out what's wrong with you once you get to that point where you're like, well, I don't feel good, you know? Mm-hmm. And then you're chasing health. And that's a really painful place to be in, especially if you're like 20 and you just want to be enjoying life. Or I was 25 or 26 and started having miscarriages and couldn't have babies. And all my friends were having babies. And I'm just like, what the heck is going on? Like, why is my body not working? So it's, you know, it's just becoming very normal to have issues. And so to understand how to rebalance and take nourish yourself on a daily basis so that you feel balanced and good is the way to go, like hands down. And it's not always the fun, like you're not always like the cool kid going to McDonald's or whatever, but it's like, can't we shift to like make it cool to be eating healthy? And, you know, I don't know.
You have to be a rebel now because what is it? Whole milk and certainly raw milk is outlawed from schools, but strawberry milk and chocolate milk are totally fine.
That was like the worst. When I was back in Massachusetts, I tried for 10 years. I don't know, maybe not that long, but to change the school lunches. And I was like, what about raw milk? You know, like I just healed my child of severe eczema, my baby, with just putting him on raw milk and cod liver oil. Totally healed after, you know, steroid cream and Zyrtec, all the whole thing. And it was like, you know, it's illegal. Like you can't buy it in Massachusetts unless it's directly from the farm, but it's also illegal to sell whole milk at school, but you can sell, it's too much fat content.
Right,
and I was just
right.
This is so weird. So, I mean, public school systems are very hard to change because it's so tied in with the federal guidelines of what the food pyramid says is healthy. And it's just so backwards. It's so backwards. So you really have an educated superintendent or head of food service, you know, that's going to understand how to make those changes to the best of their ability. And it starts with saying no to government subsidies a lot of the time, you know? So we're up against big things.
Yeah. And I do think it will become cool again. You know, I remember some vegetarians who were really into macrobiotic and growing their own everything, really lived just down the street. And I was really happy to be able to train on mountain bikes with one of the brothers there for a while. And it just like, that was the coolest thing to me at the time, how into it the whole family was and how committed everyone was and how just interesting and unique. Every single meal when I ate with them was just so fascinating and so different. And I would hope at some point that people start to catch on and realize that it's so worth it. And especially when you have multiple people on board in your community who, you know, a BYOB and bring everything of your own potluck type situation. It's like some of the most fun memories I have from childhood up to now. And we just did one like last weekend. And it's just such a wonderful experience and ritual even that's being missed out on especially now in this environment.
It's so true. I know we've talked about all meeting up at the beach and bringing food and just like, you know, because that's just so, we're so missing all of that. But I was going to say, if you can engage your kids, whether it's like, you know, you said the macrobiotic family, or engage them in some sort of, if they fall for something, whether it's making the sourdough, or now I've got my teenager making water kefir. And literally over lunch just now, he knows now to like watch out, but he popped the top and like the entire top, the metal brackets and everything went flying across the room. I mean, it was like the champagne experience, but it's like he's learning about fermentation and they like it, you know? I mean, he was like all summer long, he was on the East Coast, but drinking LaCroix, which isn't like the worst, but it's like, you know, do you really need to have three bubbly waters every day? Like that's just not good for the environment.
It's so cool right now.
So cool. But, you know, to show that you can easily for pennies make something that's just as good and, you know, cool to be able to know how to make it. So it's trying to find what ignites them, you know, if there's something that they can do.
Totally. I remember my grandmother for the holidays would make her own root beer. And, you know, like we were used to Barks back then. Remember Barks root beer? Barks has bite or whatever. And it had a completely different flavor. But it was so interesting to me because I'm like, what is this funky, weird stuff? And I kind of, it was addictive in kind of a healthy way, if that makes sense, where you do crave it, but you like crave it as a tonic every once in a while, much more than just like you plow through three of them, if that makes sense.
Right. Totally. I know. I was like, maybe I should bring back the beet kvass shot. I was looking at one of our, we do like a lunch leader, and I would do that with the kids at school, like the high schoolers. I'd be like, come on, let's do a shot.
We'd That's amazing.
And, you know, it kind of became a thing, like a healthy peer pressure. And but I was just one of our, we train lunch leaders, and one of them has like a little 3-year-old boy, and she just posted on Instagram them doing their little beet kvass shots and showing their pink tongues.
So cool.
And it's like, you know, it's just, it's a tonic, right? It doesn't have to be, there's some things that I say, you know, for my kids to take that is just like, this is a non-negotiable, like you just, you know, I'm sorry, I'm your mom and I want you to be healthy and you just gotta suck it up. So, but you know, I don't know that if that will backfire in the end where they'll be like, I'm never have, as soon as they're on their own, they'll be like, I'm never having that again. But you know, you have a certain amount of time where they're growing their brains and their bodies. And when you have that impact, like in that opportunity, you have to take it. And that's where I feel like at the school lunch level, it was like every day, if I could just pack in as much nutrition as I could into each kid and stand there and educate them as to why I'm doing it, you know, that at least that would be, we had their stomachs for 6 hours a day between snack and lunch. You can get a lot in, and hopefully they'll look back someday and be like, wow, I had this like crazy lunch lady that was giving me beet kvass shots and serving me bone broth every day and kefir shots, whatever. So, you know, I don't know.
What about organ meats? How do you get people, ourselves, how do we get ourselves on board, and how do we get our families on board?
I know. I think the best thing, I was saying today on this podcast or this live interview too, that, you know, it's just not, it's not the norm. Like start your kids as young as you can. Like my fifth child, I remember at this point I was like learning all the stuff and I would put liver on his little high chair and he would eat it. Like, and he'd even eat these tiny little dried fish that I got at the West Price conference. Like he just had no preconceived notions of like, this is gross,
right?
You know, whereas I was like, I don't want to eat that. Yeah. But I was about you.
I'll
feed it to you. But then, you know, as I've gotten more into it and made like my own pate and even beef liver, like I know how good it is for me and how I feel that I really have gotten a taste for chicken liver pate. The one in my cookbook, I love. I think it's just so good. And to spread it on a little piece of sourdough or cracker or carrot stick. And my daughter really likes it. The beef liver, like if you ask your farmer, like ours will slice it into thin strips. So you just literally, it's like 1 or 2 minutes per side in some bacon grease or something. It's so easy and so good. And you don't need much of it.
Yeah.
So it's, if you put it as kind of a condiment on the side and just think of it as medicinal or, you know, or really try, I mean, actually Justin told me he hates liver and he did like a liver challenge and he ate it like every day for like 2 weeks and then he started to crave it. So
right,
it is true. Your taste buds and your body craves that nutrition. I think we're so deficient that people will start to see, and it's inexpensive. So you're getting this like nutritional powerhouse. You know, you don't have to go buy like filet mignon and spend all your money on like expensive cuts of meat. Like go with the bones and the organ meats and even the tougher cuts of meat like chuck roll, or you can slow roast those things. And they're just so easy and efficient. And like a chuck roll or a pork shoulder will feed my family for days. And I literally just put it in a pot and put, you know, some peppercorns and sometimes some like pork shoulder. I'll do like some cacao or cinnamon, and I salted the day before, but you don't even have to. Rosemary, orange slices on top and pop it in the oven overnight at like 285. And in the morning you have like beautiful shredded pulled pork for like days.
Yeah.
So, you know, and so, and even like with the, I was talking today about to my egg farm about chicken feet and chicken heads, and you really honor the whole animal honor the animal by using the whole animal and getting over that squeamishness of just like, ew, like I don't want to touch a foot or a head, but it's like that animal died so that you can get the nutrition from it, you might as well utilize as much as you can. And that's filled with collagen and gelatin. But it took me like a year to put feet in my broth and then another year to put heads in. And now I'm just like, I'm all in.
Yeah.
And when you're healing, like she was saying this too, she has ulcerative colitis. And it's like when you're healing something, you really get over it really fast. Or you're healing a child, you're just like, I'll do whatever it takes. And you're picking every piece of cartilage off of every bone and, you know, sucking the marrow out of whatever.
You
and
did that last night.
Right? The marrow is so good. Like, oh my gosh, getting marrow bones and roasting those.
Yeah.
It's so satisfying. And so, so I think a lot of people have this guilt around eating animals and thinking that they're bad for the environment. But that's why I'm really passionate about highlighting those people that are so conscious and connected and regenerative and doing the right thing. And so it's very liberating when you can feel okay. I think a lot of children feel that they're doing this terrible thing and they're sacrificing nutrition and feeding their bodies to save the animals or the environment, when really it's like that can be detrimental to their health in these formative years where they're growing their brains and everything. And so to expose them to, you know, this, my egg farmer is this young, adorable mom and her husband, and they're just, they're doing everything right, no compromise, you know, and they're starting to educate people. And that's what we need, are people to stand up and like, we're exposing the farmer behind the food, so you can put a name to the face and then hear directly from them about the integrity. And because there's just so much confusion with the whole diet dogma and everything right now. It's so unfortunate. The labeling of everything is hurting people.
Yeah. Once again, just completely absurd at this point. But what are some, so definitely going for the throwaway cuts of meat that are meant for pets or whatever, right? Because nobody buys them. Oftentimes we would get it and still do it for $1 a pound, $3 a pound, $5 a pound max, or often they'll just give it to us for free with, you know, like we'll buy some other cuts. And so we try to get a wide variety and cook it low and slow, and, you know, throw a few things in the pot, like you mentioned. And it's really, it doesn't have to be much more complicated than that. What are some other ways, especially for families, to save while eating right today? Because that's something anyone who's shopping on a regular basis notices that it's skyrocketing, you know, like, yeah, certain things especially.
And you can throw around that pork shoulder, the chuck roll, you can throw your potatoes, carrots, onions, all that too, so that it's like a one pot under, and you just chop up some salad if you have it and be done with it. But also another good way to get organ meats in is you can have it, and this is the way my kids prefer it, is to have it ground right into your burger.
Yeah, we do that.
So that's like, or you can have it ground and then mix it half and half or a quarter and three quarters.
So great.
And you can make sauces with that or just burgers, and it's like, tacos, so easy. So roasting a whole chicken, two chickens, goes a long way into making an initial meal where you can have, again, you can have your carrots, onions, celery, or whatever all around, and your roasted chicken, and then serve it with some veg on the side. Then you can make it into you can pull all the remaining meat off the bones and save it, and then turn it into a bone broth. I often save my bones in the freezer until I have enough to make a bone broth, or I add the heads and the feet and some additional carrots, onions, celery into my broth. But then I can make a chicken salad, I can make chicken tacos, I can make chicken soup, you can make other soups with your bone broth. So it's like you're getting all of this deep nutrition and several meals out of, you know, an initial effort in the kitchen.
Yeah.
So it's about setting yourself up. And we're doing that with our boxes that we're doing a meal plan delivery service right now, that we're going to have the Hilary box, which is exactly meant to be that, like, cook once, eat several times, with the chuck roll, or the pork shoulder, or the roasted chickens, and just teaching people about different cuts of meat and how to make it easy and simple and nutrient dense and delicious. So I'm trying to think of other simple ways. I mean, I think if you have solid proteins, you know, it's just so easy to just fill around the edge. I mean, like, I literally just had one sweet Italian sausage from my farmer, and then I had some beautiful corn tortillas from my local food purveyor, and my raw cheese, and I just like took out the pork sausage and cooked it all up, split it up three ways, and made like beautiful quesadilla pork quesadilla. But it was like one sausage, you know, it wasn't a ton, but it was enough to, in the good fat, I cooked it up in the sausage grease. So they're all like, you know, coated in lots of good fats. And
what, how about maybe, stocking up, and having some staples around if you can't leave the house or you just want to make sure that people are fed? How do you balance that with feeding people things that aren't white sugar and aren't white flour? You know, the typical things that people stock up on.
Yeah, I think I know that's, it's so interesting because I don't feel this need to go to the grocery store for like chips or cereal or any of that stuff. Like it's just not, I more would stock up my freezer with healthy proteins. Right. And then I would go to the store, the farmer's market for my veg and just supplement with what's seasonal. And then, nuts, like, you know, we'll get a big, big, huge, you know, 20 pounds or whatever of, or five, I don't know, for school we got like 20 pounds.
That's a lot of nuts.
But you can literally, like, I soak my nuts. This is my cookbook too, but you want to break down the protective coating on the outside, those enzyme inhibitors and phytic acid. A lot of people, even I have trouble digesting nuts. Like if I just eat too many nuts, I can be like, oh, that was just too many nuts.
Yeah.
They're pretty hard on our digestive system. So you have to soak them in salted water and break them down. And then I dehydrate them, but you can even just leave them in your fridge. But so making nut butters is a great option. Hard boiling eggs. Eggs are like so easy. One of my kids just had the new favorite in my house is a BLT salad. So we make our bacon on the stove, and you can even get chunks. Like you can get the pieces that are often cheaper too, because they're just the end cuts of bacon.
Yeah, so good too.
And so we save all of our bacon grease. Like at school, we had like tubs of bacon grease.
That's so great.
And cook in that and just add it into everything. But so you take the bacon grease and you use that as your oil to make a dressing. So you add a little bit of vinegar to it, like white wine vinegar, a little bit of Dijon mustard, and you can add like a teaspoon of honey, put it in a mason jar, shake it up. Then you've got your lettuce, tomato, bacon, pour your dressing over the top, and oh my God, put a little kraut with that. And then you can even make, we've been cutting up our sourdough and making croutons in bacon grease on the stove and adding a few of those in there, and it's kind of heavenly.
Oh man, my stomach is grumbling now.
It's not super, you know, it's just these quick and easy things. And I keep saying to my kids, like, just make sure you get adequate protein. And I mean, I had a friend of mine a couple of years ago who's texted me, actually Diana Rogers, you probably know her, for who wrote
Sacred.
Yeah, she is from Carlisle, Mass, which I used to live next door in Concord. And she texted me, she's like, I don't know that you're getting enough protein in your day. And I was like, really? And so I think a lot of people are deficient in protein and not understanding, because especially the guidelines right now are based on, you know, not the average weights of what people weigh much more than the average.
Yes.
You know, guideline, unfortunately. But so it's important to know your macros and how you're getting your nutrition. And so I try and make sure my kids understand that they have to have that. That's going to keep them satisfied.
Yeah.
And not, you know,
not
just
ramen
craving
noodles.
Yeah. I mean, when you increase your fat too, you're going to decrease your sugar cravings without a doubt.
Yeah.
So when you're truly satiated, and I think that's, like, we don't have a lot of sweets in the house, but like even my child just had to do a virtual school Canyon Day challenge. And he's like, Mom, I'm going to cook something. I want to make something with chocolate. And I happen to have like a Lily's chocolate bar. And he was channeling Gordon Ramsay and made this whole like sponge cake thing and stuff. But we made it pretty nutrient. I mean, it was still a sweet, but you know, they had it. And then it was like kind of they're over it. You know, it was like every once in a while we... And it was so cool because I'm not a baker at all. I'm terrible. Like, I just want to throw stuff in and it never works. But he 12 and he did it. And we had this like beautiful little muffin cups of sponge cakes. And we had like all raw cream in the middle with shredded ginger.
Cool.
And, you know, we used monk fruit sweetener. And so it was, you know, it was fun. We used einkorn flour. And so to not make things totally I mean, I'm really bad at this, but to not make things totally off limits, you know, like allowing them to still have that time in the kitchen to experiment with.
It's fun to dabble things. Sometimes.
Exactly. You know,
I can't believe it, but we're already up on time. Before we go, Hilary, please tell folks where they can find you, your work, and what's coming up next.
Yes. Yeah, so, okay. You can find me on Instagram at School of Lunch. So we've launched School of Lunch. It used to be Live Yum Yum. And now we are an online educational platform, which is coming. But right now we've got these soul boxes, SOL. So if you go to mysoulbox.com, standing for School of Lunch, we're delivering farm fresh foods with meal plans, direct, very minimal waste. So things are not like packaged in a million different things. And we're really about empowering people with like, you know, fat boxes, how to have healthy fats and stuff like that. But right now we're waiting for our warehouse to be up and running, get our refrigeration and everything in there. So that's like 2 to 3 weeks away, hopefully. But we're doing our lunch boxes where we're now giving or distributing boxes throughout LA to school children meant to give them again. Like, I'll show you real quick. We have like, basically, you can see this.
Yeah.
The lunch box, and it's in the link in the bio, but it's like five, you have everything you need to make five easy, simple lunches. And it's meant to empower your kids in the kitchen because parents are like totally overwhelmed with everything right now. So if you can get kids cooking and start the conversations, then we're doing a Know Your Farmer, Know Your Food, sort of Instagram live type thing where they can start to connect with the people behind their food to make it more sustainable. So that's where we are right now. I guess if they go to School of Lunch and link in the bio, they can see all of it, or mysoulbox.com.
Very cool.
And the book, the Heal Your Gut Cookbook, if they need to heal their guts.
Awesome one. You can tell that like we get sent books all the time, and you can tell that some of them were created by people who have never even tried those recipes. And you can tell the ones that, you know, have a lot of heart in them, a lot of soul, a lot of intention. And this falls into the latter category. I'm a big fan. So
we're like in it to win it at that point. I had five little kids. But you know what? My co-author was so sick with digestive issues and stuff that she couldn't try half of the recipes because she couldn't have garlic and onions. I mean, that's what right. I mean about layers. Disease. So, and I just heard you say on one of your podcasts that you wrote your book to be, you know, to withstand the test of time.
Hopefully.
And
so.
I was like, yeah, that really is how I feel about the recipes in my book, that they're traditional, you know, mm-hmm. they've been around with a little modern day twist, but you know, they're really meant to be, kind of coming from our ancestral wisdom, if you will.
Yeah. And it really runs the gamut of like that spectrum of different kinds of foods that you want to draw from and then, you know, use as templates to experiment with hopefully down the road. So yeah, good on you.
Right. Yeah. Well, it was so fun chatting. And if people have questions or whatever, just ping me on Instagram. I'm super accessible and happy to chat with
you. Yeah, your Instagram is great. It's one of the better ones. Please go follow her. All right, Hilary, thank you so much for spending your time with us.
Thank you.
Hey, folks, this is Abel James, New York Times bestselling author and host of The Fat Burning Man Show. I'm here with a quick video on behalf of Wild Superfoods, our family company, with Adrenal Stack, our brand spanking new supplement, which is a combination of adaptogenic herbs and nutrients. And so when you take these pills, which I'll show you right here, this is the size, not too big, pretty convenient. Serving size is 3 at a time. You get more than 100% of your daily value of vitamin C. You also get a combination of different B vitamins, American ginseng, ashwagandha, rhodiola, licorice, and much more. So this is one that I've been taking for many years, especially when I'm doing recording marathons, I'm on the road, writing a lot, or just under a lot of stress, you know, like being on reality TV shows and that sort of thing, or just working 14-hour days. You know how it is. These little guys will give you a boost. So if you're interested in Adrenal Stack, then you can find it over at wildsuperfoods.com. And once again, this is Abel James. I really appreciate you folks being in touch, and I can't wait to hear how you like our brand spanking new supplement, Adrenal Stack. Once again, you can find it at wildsuperfoods.com. This is Abel signing off. We'll be in touch. Hey, it's Abel one last time, and I just want to say thank you for listening to this episode of Fat Burning Man. Before you go, please smash that like button, hit subscribe, or even leave us a quick review. It helps so much more than you even realize. And if you can think of someone else who you care about, friend, family member, anyone else who might appreciate this free show, then please take a quick second just to share it with them. Word of mouth is really the way that we've grown this show over the years. We have more than, at this point, 4 awards in independent media, 50 million downloads. We couldn't do any of this without you, so we really appreciate it.